Good morning. Welcome to all of you, whether you've been here a long time, I'll try not to look at any of you individuals, whether you've been here a long time, whether it's been a long time, or whether this is your first time, it is wonderful to be in God's house together with you. And I am so eager this morning, especially, to welcome the executive director of our diocesan summer camp, Camp Bishopswood. Mike Douglas is here this morning. Mike, would you just raise your hand so people know who you are? Mike is here to share the good word with us, both of the gospel and the gospel of camp, kind of both. And we'll be here to share and to talk with anybody who's interested in our diocesan summer camp afterwards during coffee hour. Let's see. I need to say welcome to those of you who are joining us on the live stream. Hello to you, and thank you for tuning in to our live stream. And now, the moment we've all been waiting for, our opening hymn. So I invite you to stand as we sing hymn 200, Come Ye Faithful, Raise the Strain.
Thank you.
Hallelujah! Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah!
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Acts. Peter addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this you are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself has made this man strong whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You. Holy Gospel of our Savior, Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for ghosts do not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Good morning, and please be seated. The good news is the nice folks at the early service said that my half-hour sermon was all right, but that you are all up for 45 minutes, so I'm ready. Are you guys comfortable? No, thank you. I'm Mike. Greetings from Bishop Thomas and all the staff at the Loring House. It's good to be back at St. Albans. I think it's been about 6 or 7 years, and so thank you for letting me come back. There's so much in today's Gospels and readings that we could talk about, but I kind of want to focus on three things if you're one of those people who like to keep track in your head. These are kind of the three things. The first one is peace be with you. What does that mean? Second, the power of a meal. And then lastly, verse 48, you are a witness of these things. In today's gospel, Jesus says, "Peace be with you." What exactly does that mean? Too often, I think we think of peace as simply the end of a conflict. And of course, clearly, the end of a conflict is a good thing. But I think the peace Jesus refers to here is more than the absence of something negative. Indeed, I think it has its own presence and gravity. When someone reports feeling at peace, for instance, they're reporting more than an absence of conflict, but a sense of wholeness, a sense of harmony with those people and the things around them. Peace implies a sense of contentment, but even more fulfillment, a sense that in this moment, one is basking in God's pleasure. And that can come even amid hardship, struggle, conflict, or disruption. This is what we try to do at camp. When kids are camp, we want them to know they are special, that they are loved for and cared for by a whole community, and that they can find peace at this place called Bishopswood like no other place. I'm going to try to share an example of that with you. It's a story of, we'll call them the Joneses. About 7 years ago, I started working with another parish in the diocese to get two local kids from their community to camp. The parish would provide the transportation and half the tuition, and Bishopswood would provide the rest. This summer, we're on track to give away over $80,000 in scholarships. When we say we will not stop anyone from coming to camp, that we really mean it. Their second summer, their mom emailed me and said she had saved $50 for each kid and now has her own transportation and can't wait to see camp. Last summer at camp, we had believers, Episcopalians, Catholics, claimed atheists, Jewish, Muslim, and non-church kids at camp. I believe camp is fertilizing a seed in kids, that when they have times of doubt or frightened like the disciples in today's gospel were, they can remember this safe place or something more powerful than themselves. I'll continue with the story. We'll call them Skylar and Colby, the two kids that came to camp. At first, they were very quiet. They weren't quite sure what to make out of this place. They kind of slowly start getting involved, and you could tell they were thinking about what was going on back home. But as soon as you get involved with the activities like swimming in beautiful Lake McGuntook or playing sports and games and arts and crafts and performing arts and hiking in our low ropes course, the fun and the magic of camp just kind of happens. 1 week their first summer turned into 5 weeks by their last summer. It became clear they loved camp, and camp changed them. I asked Skylar his very last day of his very last summer what he learned about his Bishopwood experience, and this is what he said. I learned how to be a better person inside, to take care of the environment, and to open up to everybody. That fall, he also sent a message to his counselor, and here's a short part of what it said. I want to say thank you for all the laughs and smiles we had and all the things I did for the first time because I was too shy to do it. But seeing you do some of this stuff really opened my eyes. I look up to you like a big brother. You influenced me to be better in life. I can't make this stuff up. This happens all the time at camp, every day, every year. Is this what Jesus meant by peace be with you? It doesn't matter if you are rich or poor, come to camp broken or on top of the world. Camp meets kids where they are and transforms them into better people. You see, camp for many kids can do a couple of things. One, it can reinforce and strengthen the love of God they've been taught at home or in their churches. Or second, what I just find the most powerful, is to watch a child who experiences the real peace of God through the community of camp for the first time in their life. Second, let's talk about the power of a meal. As the disciples were frightened and doubted it was Jesus standing next to them, Jesus, after revealing himself, quickly asked them if they had any food. Have you ever experienced how just sitting down and eating with folks can make a situation better? In the last couple of months, there have been many references to Jesus sitting around a table in the gospel readings. I grew up outside of Utica, New York. I love going home, being with family, and seeing friends. But a trip back home always includes a couple of things. One, pizza. No one makes pizza like you can get in Utica, New York. Second is tomato pie. And if you know anything about tomato pie, it's entirely different than pizza. And you also have to have a half moon cookie from Hemstraat's Bakery. But the thing that would not make a trip home complete was if I didn't visit the Ezzo House. Val was one of my closest friends in high school, and her family was my second family. Carmela, Val's mom, was always in the kitchen cooking something that just smelled so good. Graham was always sitting around the dining room table and just kind of engaging you in conversation. But the thing was, as much as she was engaging you in conversation, she was talking about her faith and talking about just being a powerful witness in the world. Aunt Nettie was always on the couch getting all the kids wound up and then 15, 20 more people around the house. Going to the Ezzos and sitting at their table, I imagine gave me a similar feeling to those surrounded by Jesus in today's gospel. I would seek it out to strengthen me for the next part of my journey and to make me feel good, or one could say at peace. I also think this was comforting to Jesus to share a meal with his people at such a stressful time. I also believe this is how many kids feel about camp, or how many of you may feel about worshiping right here at St. Albans, or spending time at Preble Street, or the St. Elizabeth's Pantry. Kids repeatedly refer to camp as their second home, a place where they can be themselves, know that they are loved, and to feel at peace. Have you ever felt at peace sitting at a table, sharing a meal with a loved one or strangers? The third point from today's gospel, verse 48, you are witnesses to these things. What does it mean to be a witness? For me, it's not just seeing or being a part of something, but it's about sharing that experience you were a part of. I would like to close with something that Lilla, a member of our camp community, shared with me. I can't think of a better story to share about the power of being a witness. Here's Lilla's story. During our final chapel last summer, bracelets were distributed to everyone at camp. Made by the chaplain and their family, each individual bracelet varied in color and bead shape. The bracelet I chose had a circular orange bead threaded through a thin pink and blue string. While tying it to my wrist, the chaplain began to speak about the message she hoped to convey with the bracelets. Like us, each element of the bracelet is unique in their own ways. These distinct differences held by each one of them were used in order to represent the necessity of individuality within and outside the camp community. She went on to explain that regardless of where we went in the world, after the end of that week, this idea would stay true. About 2 weeks after receiving the bracelet, I was studying abroad in South Africa. There were many moments during my 15 weeks away from home where it was clear that camp had familiarized me with many aspects of life in an intentional community. However, there was one particular moment of the trip where I could directly recognize camp's effect on my community engagement. As I spent 4 days rafting on the Zambezi River, my friends and I relished in many stories told by our guides. On the second night, the lead guide for our trip, Emma, sat down next to me and initiated a conversation. He provided me with detailed description of his daily life on the river, speaking to me about the solace he found going down in the gorges. Following this, he then credited his endless river trips to God. He claimed that this spiritual aspect of his life was the leading factor of fulfillment he feels on the water. Instead of waiting for me to respond, he then posed a question. What is your relationship with religion? After pausing to think about this inquiry, my mind wandered to Bishopswood. Seeing as I do not practice any religion in my home, camp is the largest exposure I have to religious practices throughout the year. So I began to speak with Emma about my time at camp, the connections I have formed, my ideas pertaining to faith. At this point, we were delivering stories back and forth for about an hour around the fire when I remembered that last night of chapel. Before I attempted to tell the story, I tugged at the string on my left wrist. As the knot loosened slightly, I started to relay an explanation of the chaplain's ideas, as well as the love I had felt at that moment. Then finally finishing my story, I asked Emma if he would like to keep the bracelet. I would love to, he beamed. Without hesitation, he began loosening a bracelet off of his own wrist to give to me and returned. Through my earnest curiosity, I became a part of the Bishopswood community. In the same way, Emma became an extension of it that night. Without my time at camp, I wouldn't have possessed the capacity to form connections in such an open and trusting manner. Now, because of camp, I actively seek perspective in order to gain nuanced ideas of the world. I'm eternally grateful for this community enveloped in the faith of love, openness, non-judgment, and curiosity for those exact reasons. Lilla is 17 years old. She was a counselor in training last summer and will be a junior counselor this summer. We are so lucky to have someone like Lilla to be a witness of her experience at Camp Bishopswood. As we leave here today, let us be witnesses of all the good things happening right here at St. Albans, in the Diocese of Maine, and the world around us. Peace be with you.
On page 6 of your order of service or on page 358 of the Book of Common Prayer. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made,
of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people can be found on page 7 in your order of service. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory to the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide the people of this land and all nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all whose lives closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Let us pray especially for Anne and Art, for Austin, for Barb, for Bill and Sadie, for Brad and Alice, for Christy, for David, for Deanna and her family, for Deb, for Dawn, for Howard, for Jane, for Jerry, for Jessica, for John, for Jude. Pray for Kevin and Margaret and Marty, for healing for Nancy and John, for Patricia, for Rachel, for Robin, for Roger, Donna, and their family, for Stacy, for the Sutherland family, for Tom. I invite you to add your own petitions now, silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I invite you to turn and exchange signs of peace. Well, I don't want to interrupt this hugging and things that are going on here. Certainly that's important, and that's why we pass the peace with one another. It's a great day, a beautiful day to be together. Mike, thank you again for your message and for being here with us. As some of you know, I stand before you as a person whose life was deeply transformed by the ministry of summer camp. And I worked at camp down in Tennessee for about 5 years, including 2 years full-time. And I can tell you that it's unlike any other context of ministry. People find God in the strangest places and in the strangest combinations of people. And so I commend that to you, Mike. I thank you so much for your work. Thank you for your ministry and for being here with us. Mike will be here this morning to talk about that. At the 8 o'clock, I said, you know, Mike, we may not be able to deliver a whole lot of kids for you at the 8 o'clock. I don't know how that's going to go. And he was really quick with it. He said, yeah, but all those grandparents have grandkids. So this man knows what he's doing, and we're so lucky in this diocese to have him here with our summer camp. There are a few other announcements, and I just want to make note of a couple of them. We are having the adult forum. It's going to be in the upper room, and the topic today is the kingdom of God. So I don't know how more, it doesn't get more interesting than that. The kingdom of God, right? It includes everything. And the second announcement I have is that we're having a middle school art activity at 11 o'clock in the annex. And finally, I want you to know we have a list 10 miles long of little doodad projects that can be done around the church. And the list needs to be completed. We may get 5 people and complete 5 things, and that will be great. But how much better would it be if we got a bunch of people and got a bunch of things done? And so this is my plea to you. All hands on deck. On next Saturday for our parish work day, there's a lot that can be done to spruce up our building and our grounds. And Debbie Fisher has done such good work, along with all of the staff and with the building and grounds, and putting all of that together so that it's come and everything's organized for you. So if you'd like more information, Debbie's in the back. She'll be around during coffee hour, and you can be part of a fun day of work. Judy Sides has an announcement.
I do. Good morning. First of all, I want you all to know that Tom and I met at summer camp.
All right.
And here we are, still going. There's a dire need at St. Elizabeth's right now, and I am pleading with all of you to try to go to your linen cupboards, your kitchen cupboards, places in your house that you haven't gone to in a while, clean them out, and you'll be so happy with yourself that you have done this wonderful project, and we can fill the shelves at St. Elizabeth's. There are no linens, there are no sheets, there are no towels, there are no big pots. We did not open this Tuesday except for the essentials, and we are not opening next week except for the essentials, which are the toilet paper, soap, laundry, detergent, and those items. But there is nothing else being given out because we have nothing. The shelves are bare. So let's fill the shelves. Thank you.
Last time we said fill that rack, we got like 85 coats.
We did.
Right. So fill those shelves. Are there any other announcements? Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice unto God.
Christ is our cornerstone, our hero, our Redeemer. With his crucifixion.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks, for you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and fill them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day. And beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise, joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven. We acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing. We acclaim you, Holy Lord, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior, incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. To the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death. And rising from the grave, destroyed death and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his return in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us this bread and this cup, We praise you and we bless you. We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we praise to you, Lord, our God. Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. And grant that we may find our inheritance with St. Alban and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ and with Christ, and in Christ. All honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as Christ our Savior has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died and rose for you, and feed upon him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Our post-communion prayer is found on page 365 of the Book of Common Prayer and on page 12 in your order of service. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now may the peace, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.